My job, like everyone else's job here, really is to correct our mistakes. Okay, so I try not to make mistakes. Sometimes I make mistakes, mundane mistakes. I may have made a mistake in the interpretation of the dream of the lady in all in red, the red lady in the red dress, all red lady woman. I gave a mundane interpretation of this, so I'm going to look at this again, based on what has happened since this morning when I made the video. There's another interpretation of this dream that may be the correct one, but I have to be forgiven, or forgive myself for not even thinking about that, because it may be a very sublime dream. It was a very numinous dream, to say the least, but I may have sold myself short. It may be actually a very, very amazing dream. I gave it this spin because of the problem I had with the virus on my computer related to China and all this, and I was kind of feeling like this was what the motif was, and my awareness that there could very well be a cyber attack, a cyber war coming up very soon that China is part of, but they're being used as a patsy, actually. The real cyber attack is structured at a deeper level than what you call the Illuminati, the cabal, whatever you want to call it, and even deeper than that. So I interpreted the dream along those lines, and it was a plausible interpretation. But subsequent events have shown that this may not be actually the right interpretation. Now, our dreams are notoriously tricky to decipher, but they can be deciphered. I've been looking at the whole dream again more carefully. I say, okay, now wait a minute. There is another explanation. And so I will explain this to you because it's quite important, quite amazing, actually. The dream was that I was on this marathon, and the route took us to this, like a stairway made of metal, like a scaffold, like type of thing, but it was a staircase. It was open air staircase going up. You had to have handrails, and it was a like mesh steel steps going up, like a construction staircase sort of thing. And went way, way up, way, way up, way, way up. This is part of the test of the marathon. And I went way up there. I said, I got to make this. I got to make it. And then I reached a certain place where suddenly it became foggy, and you couldn't see anything. And so every you didn't you couldn't see where you were going up. And I got real nervous, and I realized this was a test. This was a trial. And so I was able to compose myself and take one step at a time, and slowly go up the remaining steps. And ultimately, I reached the very top of this very, very high staircase going up into the sky. And I was very relieved to reach the top. And there were some attendants at the top, and they were delighted that I'd reached the top, and they gave me this plastic bracelet that showed I'd reached the top. And I was like, wow, that's great. And I was really feeling very pleased that I said this was very difficult to do this. It took so much nerve, and I had to compose my mind so extraordinarily to reach this area. And when I reached the top, it was lighted up there. It was all lighted, and there was no fog or anything. It was very nice. There's a little, sort of a landing platform up on top of this very high staircase up into the sky. And then what happened next was, suddenly there was this lady in red, all red. Red everything, red shoes, red dress, red everything. Her skin seemed to be red. She was just red. That's what my impression was, just all red. And she was causing this commotion. And she was like hysterical. Now, what I didn't quite catch the first interpretation was where did she come from? This is the question. I did see her on the staircase. She wasn't dressed for any marathon. So where exactly did this, she just appeared there, This is the thing that I couldn't quite understand. She just seemed to appear out of nowhere. I thought, well, okay, she's a complex, psychological complex that's coming from me. Okay. And she's not comfortable up so high, such exalted area where we were. So she wants, you know, she wants to get out of there. This is what I initially thought. So the dream keeps going, and nobody can calm her down. And so I turn my attention to her, and I figure out, I say, maybe she wants to go down to the earth, all right, down to earth. And she's, some reason she doesn't want to go alone down the stair. There was a staircase down toward the earth, and it was much easier staircase. Seemed pretty wide and well built and simple. I said, maybe she feels uncomfortable going down alone or something like this. So I voluntarily said, I'm going down there. So why don't I offer, I'll take your hand and I'll hold on to your hand, make sure you don't fall. I thought maybe she was feeling unstable or unsteady or something. And I just being a gentleman, you know, I'll just bring her down the staircase back to earth. And as soon as I offered that, she agreed and took my hand, and we walked down the staircase together, and she was very calm, peaceful, and was like, no problem at all. So I said, okay, that's the problem. That was the problem. And then when I got near to the earth, she seemed to say, okay, and parted from me, and she went somewhere. I didn't see exactly where she went. I said, huh. She seemed very confident. Yeah, it's a difficult dream, but there's been some clues coming in, very strong clues. So it's really worth looking at this. The thing is, where did she come from is the first question. Now, I walked into church today, Catholic church, and it was all dressed in red. I said, what's going on? And immediately it struck me. The lady in red was the same color. All the red banners were the same color. And I said, oh my gosh, I think it's Pentecost. It's Pentecost Sunday. This is the descent from above of the Holy Spirit. So this dream took place in the early morning of Pentecost. And the lady was dressed in red, the same color as all the church used. Everyone's, you know, dressed in red. The priest is wearing this red. It's the same color. This lady was all in red. As that got my attention, and I said, whoa, maybe I jumped the gun on the interpretation. I got to take a closer look at this. What's going on here? Then the second amazing thing, and I only discovered this later, is that they did a second donation for Catholic Charities. And we always donate to the first donation, but I am a poor, 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 poor person. And, we give a little bit, but usually if there's a second collection, we don't give. So this time, for some reason, the guy went up and gave a sob story about some Chandra or some Chandra, I think. Interesting, huh? Chandra. Huh. Wow. Chandra, Chandro is testering children, is that Dakini that appeared to me. So it was about Chandra, so fell into all sorts of problems, and how Catholic Charities had helped her put her life back together. And I was like, oh yeah, okay, this is a really hard tugging story, but I don't have the money. I don't have, I got hardly anything on my wallet, and that's it. But I decided I'm going to give something. Just, I don't know why I decided that. So I reached in my wallet, and I pulled out a couple dollars. And I put it in the wallet, and then it was pointed out to me. Someone noticed this. They said, hey, wait a minute. It looks like a 20 in there or something. I said, what? And I looked, and there was a bill stuck to one of the ones, and it was a 10. It was a 10. So I said, whoa. So I pulled that out and put it back in my wallet. Left the $2 in there. And then I thought, wait a minute. Maybe God is trying to tell me something. I really felt God's trying to tell me something. And I thought, I'm going to put the 10 back in there and then take the 2 out. And then I had a hard time getting the 2 back in my wallet. And I said, maybe the 10 should have been 12. Maybe the 10 should have been 12. First it was 12, and then 10, maybe it should have been 12. So this 10 to 12 stuck in my mind. Okay, I can't afford giving $10, to tell you the truth. $10 is, to me, is like $1,000 to somebody else. You know, it's just, to me, that's a lot of money, actually. But I did it. So I get home, and this is bugging me. This whole thing about what that dream really meant is bugging me. And so I decided I do a Google search. I decided to put in red Dakini. I just, for some reason, I said red Dakini. I said, I wonder if this was some sort of spiritual being. Because I had this alternate theory. Okay, now. Then what came up was Vajra Yogini, the lady all in red. She's depicted as all red. And immediately I said, wow, that fits. That fits. And then I realized here's an alternative explanation of this dream that really fits. Because where did this lady appear out of? She didn't climb the staircase. She must have come down from above somehow, or just appeared there somehow. And she gave this hysterical, disconsolate. Nobody, and the reason was nobody would accompany her down into the world. She wanted to be accompanied. She didn't want to just go by herself. For some reason, she felt it was inappropriate. And so she put on this act, I'm so hysterically upset, because she knew that I was there and I would ask her, I would agree to accompany her down into the world. This is the trickster aspect of the Dakinis, right? They can play the hysterical card, and they're very adept at this. If you look at it this way, is this Vajra Yogini, which is really the female Buddha, and the highest of all tantric deities, Vajra Yogini, actually. And she's depicted as this all red lady, also all red, and that's exactly what was there. And she may have just shown up from this may have been her Nirmanakaya body showing up there, and she just made it appear. She just appeared. She just appeared. This is what happened. Where did this lady come from? She as if she just appeared there. So she has the power to just appear like this. And then she knew that I would be willing to accompany her down into the world. So bringing her down into the world, which I would do. I wasn't intimidated by it. I said, yeah, I'll do it. You spend all the time I've spent with Sri Sri Anandamayi, and nothing intimidates you anymore in terms of spiritual. She's Vajra Yogini herself, so Vajra Sattva, Vajra Yogini, Narayana, Purna Brahma Narayana, you name it. So Vajra Yogini may have wanted some consort, to help bring her into the world, bring her grace. Now, the all redness is very important, isn't it? Because we have found out that red is the color in Tibet of Dharma protection, absolute Dharma protection. And there was nothing more red than this lady, believe me. She was all red. She was all red. Meaning just all about protecting the Dharma. This is interpretation, right? Totally, total. But she needed some way to be invited into the world or something, right? So she couldn't, she was disconsolate because she couldn't get into the world, because nobody was inviting her into the world, apparently. And no one was willing to do it. And then she must have known that I was willing to do it. And I'd somehow reached some high level of awareness by going through the fog and being able to do this. So I'm comfortable with the non-dual perspective. We're all absolutely innocent. Every single one of us is absolutely innocent. This is a fact. No one has ever done anything. Nothing has ever happened. We're perfectly innocent. No matter how we try, we can never lose our perfect innocence. This is a fact. And this is just frozen up for some reason. But it says it's still capturing, so I'll just keep on going. Yeah. Oh, well, par for the course here. So, it could have been that I was, by reaching this very clear high level through tremendous courage and determination, that she was able to then meet me at that level, appear there, and then and ask for help to come into the world. And I was willing to, you know, give her help to come into the world. This is a very spiritual interpretation of the dream, which sort of fits, well, more than sort of, it very much fits the dream. I remember at the beginning of the marathon, Muji was there, and he had just finished the marathon. He'd finished it, and I said, "Muji, you know, how was it?" He goes, "Oh, it's great." He says, "I think I'll do it again." You know, I said, "Wow, I think I'll do it." He's motivated. Muji motivated me to do it. You know, which is true, that Muji motivated me to do these videos, to start taping on YouTube, because I saw what he was doing. And I said, "Wow, that's great, what he's doing. I really love what he's doing." Just sharing the Dharma with the world on YouTube. And I said, "Let me start doing this." So it was a very spiritual dream. Now, this Vajrayogini is something else I didn't know about it, really. My gosh, the write-up on her is just, she's like the ultimate, the highest of all tantric deities. You know, just with this extraordinary capacity to free us from death, to free us from the afterlife, just completely the full array. I mean, this is a completely full-on Dharma protector. Now, I've been praying to Longchenpa for a miracle, right? And I give Longchenpa full permission and full empowerment to do any and everything required to protect us from this scourge of spiritual materialism. So, let that be understood. What kind of miracles has he sent my way? Now, the kicker of all this that really got me willing to do this video is, remember that envelope I decided to put in $10 that I put in 12? I mean, sorry, to put in $2. I put in 12, and then I pulled out 2 for 10. So the 10, 12 and 10 were the key numbers there, right, in this whole situation. Well, on this Wikipedia write-up of Vajrayogini, it said that she was established, the tantra, the Anuttara Yoga Tantra that she's associated with, was established from the 10th century to the 12th century. From the 10th century, 12th century, 10 and 12. And again, I never would put in $12. I can't afford it. But the 10 was stuck to the 2. So you get 10 plus 2, 12. And I left the 10 in. It's like seed money. I said, okay, this is going to go to good purpose. From the 10th century to the 12th century was when this was established. The Vajrayogini was established. So I said, wow. Is that just coincidence? How could that be coincidence? That's too strong of a amazing thing, because it was seemingly coincidence that $10 bill got stuck to the back of the one. I never would have put it into 10. And then it was pointed out, someone saw it and said, "Hey, wait a minute! You realize you're putting in more money than just 2?" And I said, "Huh? What?" And I looked, "Oh my gosh! How'd that happen? That's weird." So that's really weird. I don't know how it happened. So obviously, there's a big attention getter. 10 and 12, 10th century to 12th century. This ultimate female deity, all red, completely reddish. It's exactly what I met there on top of this very high platform up in the sky, climbing the staircase. And then I took her hand, and she was very calm then. No trouble at all walking down the staircase. Whereas before she had been hysterical, like, you know, maybe she said, "Nobody will help." Maybe, you know, what I take is she's saying, "Nobody, I want to help, but nobody will, you know, invite me in. Nobody will invite me. Nobody, you know, I need someone to invite me into the world. No, I just want to help. It's so terrible now." So I'm crying. She was just crying, like something was just so bothering her so severely. And spiritual materialism and what's to come in this world is enough to bother her that way. Absolutely it is. Are you kidding? Bothers Longchenpa no end, for sure. Jesus as well. This is the worst scourge ever on this planet. One of the worst scourges ever in the universe, you could say. What's happening here on this planet right now. So, you know, it's like, obviously, not knowing about Vajrayogini, I wouldn't have interpreted it that way, so I had to come up with some other interpretation. But if you plug her into the whole mix, and then the stuff that's happened since then on Pentecost, Pentecost is the descent of the grace of God into the world. And that's exactly the day that this dream happened. You know, you start putting everything together, and this is a much more plausible interpretation of the dream, actually. And, you know, like I said, I'm not really bothered by these deities. My whole life has been spent around them. And my religion is actually direct contact with divinity, with saints, you know, however you want to call it, enlightened beings. That's always been my religion. I was in church today, Catholic Church, and I just said, this isn't my religion. I mean, what is this? It's not my religion at all. My religion is direct contact with the saints. I've always had direct contact with the saints. I've been completely focused on that my whole life. I don't need a priest or a pope or an intercessor. I'll go straight to Jesus and ask him what the truth is. I always thought, why not? Why don't people do this? It's ridiculous. That's what he loves. That's what he wants. So he'll tell you it directly instead of all these political compromises and stuff, worldly stuff. He'll tell you the truth. He'll tell you the truth. And so I've met many times with Jesus. And I met with Longchenpa. And I've met with many, many times with Sri Sri Anandamayi. And I've met with Ram Maharshi, and I've met with Krishnamurti, and you know, there's been other very, very, very high spiritual meetings I've had with Vajrasattva or Christ consciousness, and various throughout my life. I've always had these many direct encounters with these great spiritual beings, and to me, that's just normal. What, you know, this is what we're supposed to do. Again, why not? What reason exactly is there that we're not supposed to do that? There isn't really any reason, right? What are you going to say? Oh, well, you're not welcome? Really? They don't welcome you? Of course they welcome you. With open arms, they welcome you. They just long for that, for someone to ask them, what's really the truth? Can you tell me what's really the truth? And I'd like to help you. What do you want me to do to help you? Of course, this bureaucracy and all hierarchy. And they said, no, you got to go through us. You can't know what Jesus says unless you go through the priest, through the bishop, through the cardinals, through the pope, and the body of the church. We'll decide for you, you know, what Jesus has to say. And I said, whoa, wait a minute. Let's just cut out the middle man and make it all easy, and let's just go directly to Jesus and say, Jesus, we'd like to know what your teaching really is. It's just a no-brainer, right? Literally, huh? Bypass the brain, bypass the belief in matter, and go straight. So for me, this isn't any, you know, it's not anything that's difficult for me. If that was Vajra Yogini, great. I'd love to help her out. I'd love to help bring her into the world. Total Dharma protector, full-on Dharma protector of the highest order. That's what we need right now. So my wish for the world is that more people would choose direct association with the saints. Just go to them directly. Just meet them. They're not ogres or something, you know. They're delightful. They're the kindest people you'll ever meet. Or not people, but I mean, they're the kindest you will ever meet. They are absolute, like Ram Maharshi. You just cannot believe what a benevolent, kind being he is. How he looks at you with just the utmost graciousness and benevolence and kindness, with nothing but graceful words to say to you. You know, you just come away with a lasting impression. This is just the heart of kindness, and he has our welfare absolutely in his heart, absolutely in his heart. In his being, he has our welfare clearly always in mind. I just so Like, why wouldn't you want to meet someone like that? So Pentecost, very important day in Christianity, to say the least. This is when the apostles got the anointing, and those who were there and got the anointing of the Holy Spirit, and began their mission. Ultimately, their mission is to, you know, free us from spiritual materialism. That's their ultimate mission of Christianity, and we've kind of lost sight of that, haven't we? I'm tired of Catholicism, to tell you the truth. I've just had it. It's just, wow. It's just mush. You know, it's just mush. It's not sufficient to turn back what's going on in the world at all. It's ridiculous. It's just, we need to restart. It's like in construction. Sometimes you should knock the house down and build a new one instead of trying to remodel. There is no way in the world you can remodel Catholicism. There's just no way. It's a mishmash. It's better to start afresh and new. It absolutely is. And I believe a lot of people feel this way. They just realize, wow, this just doesn't have the velocity that I need. This just isn't taking me high enough, you know, to where I need to get to. We're all innocent. Nothing's ever happened. They passed out these Holy Spirit gifts of the Holy Spirit. Everyone got this little fortune cookie-like thing. I opened it up. Mine said, fear of God was the gift that I got. Fear of God. I said, fear of God? What do you mean? We're supposed to fear God? Come on. We're supposed to love God. Because God loves us. And in fact, we can never do anything to tarnish the love of God for us in the slightest bit. We don't need to earn any merit because we have perfect merit with God. There's nothing we can do to shed our innocence, okay? Not anything we can do to shed our innocence. It's impossible. We are absolutely innocent, every single last one of us, with no exception. No one left behind. So all these incarnations, what's the use? We could keep trying to prove we're not innocent. And God pays no attention. God knows we're perfectly innocent. So it's a waste of time. I mean, it's just a waste coming here in these incarnations. We literally can't be bad, you know. So why keep trying? Why keep trying? Might as well just chuck it and say, oh, what the heck, you know, I'm not coming back here. And actually, Vajrayogini is known to absolutely eradicate any further incarnations. This is free from death, free from afterlife, free from all incarnations. That's her specialty. That's why she's so high. And this is exactly what I want. This is exactly what I pray for. I told Longchamp, I want you to absolutely stand in the way of any future incarnations here and absolutely prevent it. In no way do I want to come back here. Absolutely not. And so, what did he do? Send me Vajrayogini, the specialist in eradicating any future incarnations and preventing them. Preventing death, preventing afterlife, preventing reincarnation, preventing all of this. It's like, yeah, absolutely, I'll walk with that. I'll take her down the stairs into the world. Absolutely, I will. But I mean, I got along fine. There's no problem taking her down the stairs at all. We walked in, it was no clumsy as awkward as, walked perfectly in unison down the stairs flawlessly. It's no trouble at all. Just the very idea of returning, to being born again into this world, is just enough again to just light a blowtorch of concern in me. Holy cow. Maybe the fear, that's the fear of God, the fear of returning to this world, it should be said. that's the worst fear that could possibly be. This place is absolutely an insane asylum. And the mass is you know a mass of an insane asylum. I mean, it just you can't make heads or tails of it, really. I mean, the form is all there, but the content isn't there. Not really. Not really. It's just wow. So it's better just go to Jesus, say, Jesus, what is the truth? Can you just tell me directly. I don't need anybody to interpret for me. Just tell me directly. And of course, he has worked on helping us with that. And his messages were all innocent. No, nothing's ever happened. Nothing has ever happened to us. It's impossible that anything ever happened to us. Nobody can do anything to us. Therefore, we can't do anything to anyone else either, can we? Therefore, everybody's innocent. There's no guilt whatsoever. There's no judgment whatsoever. We're all still completely free. Nothing has ever happened at all to us. We're still we've just been experiencing as we always have, except trying to deceive ourselves about what we are. But this is Jesus' message. You're not hearing that in the Catholic Church at all. God forgive me for all my sins. I've sinned with this. I sinned this. I sinned against this person. I sinned against this person. I said, no. No one's ever sinned. Nobody has ever sinned. And of course, they say, well, Jesus died for your sins. Jesus knows nobody's ever sinned. So that couldn't be what he died for. He wanted to show us that, that death is just also just imaginary. We're just pretending. He says, Lazarus, get up from the grave. You're just pretending to be dead. I know you that. And Lazarus said, oh, yeah, you're right. Sorry, Jesus. I kind of forgot, but oh, yeah. Okay. Thanks for reminding me. Tells the cripple, get up and walk. I know you're just pretending. Can't fool me. Who do you think you're trying to fool here? And the cripple says, oh, my God. Sorry, Jesus. Okay. I was just pretending. Yeah, you're right. And he gets up and no more crippledness. He says, go and sin no more to the leper or whatever, the blind. What he means is, go and pretend no more. Stop pretending to be sick. Stop pretending to be a body. Was Vajrayogini wrathful? No, she wasn't wrathful. She was disconsolate because she didn't want to be up there. She wanted to go into the world. But I guess she couldn't, find a suitable vehicle or a person or someone to accompany her or something. She needed someone to accompany her there, and that was the issue. Because when I offered, she immediately accepted the offer, and then she came in the world and she was perfectly fine. She was glad to be there. I could tell she immediately sprung into action. She was all business. She dropped my hand and dashed into the world somehow, and sprung into action. And I don't know. I lost sight of her at that point. And I said, hey, maybe I'd kind of like to see you again and ask if you're okay now, There's all these creatures moving about, I guess. I don't know. The light just went on. Oh well, what can I do? It's getting pretty late. Ah, that's so bad. So again, all empowerments and permissions to Longchamp, but we're used to gurus empowering us. How about us empowering the gurus? You see, this is something we've overlooked. We really have overlooked it. Can they really act unless we ask them to? This is the question, isn't it? Remember, Longchamp showed up when I made a great empowering prayer that I was willing to help work with and help anyone out who was willing to come here and help with the situation, who was capable of effectively helping here. And that's when Longchamp showed up, because I gave this open-ended permission for this to happen. So it's us that need to give empowerments and permissions to the gurus, to the saints, to the saviors, because that enables them to then pour their grace into the world. He can't force things if we don't want to. So I give in church today, I said, Lord Chip, I give you all empowerments and permissions, all of them. Carte blanche, all empowerments and permissions to do anything and everything that you need to do to effectively push back this scourge of spiritual materialism in this world and protect us from it. Protect the Dharma. Protect us, protect the Dharma. You have my permission, all permissions and all empowerments to do anything and everything. Period. No strings attached. See, this is what we need to do. This is what's really helpful. I mean, we got to flip the script and stop playing, you know, so meek. And we got to tell these great helpers, Dharma protectors, Dharma kings, that we give you permission to act here. I'm giving you full permission, Longchamp, to act. Any action you want to take, you've got my full permission and empowerment to do so. Whatever it is, everything, anything and everything. Plain and simple. And I said, care more and do it now. Care more and do now. I want you to care even more than you care. More care, more action right now. More care, more action right now. So I was yelling at my mind. I said, I want you to care even more. I know you care, but care more. I want you to care more. I want your caring to be just, you know, omniscient caring, just absolute total caring. And then I want all that action to be right now. Right now. All effectiveness right now. No delay. Of course, the delay comes from our saying, well, yeah, I want you to help, but not quite yet. You know, this kind of thing. No, I said right now, today, this instant. More caring. Care more. Care more. Care more. All right? So this is the attitude we need to have. We need to empower them to act. When we pray, it's not we pray to Jesus, please, Jesus, help me out in this situation. Aren't we empowering Jesus, saying, Jesus, I'm giving you the permission to act in this situation on my behalf. I'm giving you permission. You see, yeah, that's what we're doing. Because if that wasn't required, don't you think Jesus would have healed you already? Of course. What's he waiting for? He's waiting for your permission, of course. He's waiting for your willingness. Grace can't force anything. Can't force it. It needs permission. So this Vajra Yogini needed permission to act in the world, and she was disconsolate because she wasn't getting the permission she wanted. And it was just tearing her up. She was so torn up. It was really hard to take to seeing someone who was just so torn up inside. They were just beside themselves with grief. I couldn't understand it. What's going on? And she was grief stricken, but taking her in this world, the grief vanished. So she obviously was grief stricken that she wasn't getting help, you know, coming to this world. So she needed permission. Someone needed to ask her permission. You got full permission. You have my absolute full permission, Vajrayogini, to come into this world and do anything and everything this very instant with all care more, however much care you have in the world, we want more than that, you see. We want more than your full attention. Just absolutely, you know, pile it on to help. Full on. Because the scourge is going to strike very soon. So we have no time to wait. We need to give empowerments right now. And this is different. We're waiting for Longchamp to give empowerment. No, it's us that need to give him the empowerment to act. He's already done everything. But because of time, worshiping time, we don't accept it. So we need to stop worshiping time and say, okay, let's experience your grace right this instant. Okay? And that's when the grace shows up. I have had quite a few dreams of Sri Sri Nandamaya Ma within the last two, three, 4 months. It's been very recent. And it's like, wow. She's very much getting ready, very imminent. She's going to do something, really, really do something. And her healthfulness is, you know, very much focused here now. And so I know something really big is coming. So it's not a surprise then that this is continuing to unfold here. And, you know, I'm certainly one who's willing to give these empowerments. Absolutely, I already have, and I will do more. Full on, all day, let's just empower Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. All empowerment to Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. All empowerment, all permissions to take any and every action you deem effective and appropriate to protect us from this hideous scourge of materialism and spiritual materialism. You have our full permission and full empowerment to you right now, this instant. No delay, this very instant. You see, this is what they're waiting for. This is what they want. So we got to stop our waiting. We're saying, no, act now. You know, we're not saying, don't act, don't wait until it's too late. No, take action now. Take action now. So this is pretty, this is wonderful stuff, isn't it? I mean, it's really terrific. We may very well be onto something here very important, is us giving the empowerments, giving them permission. Instead of studying what they taught, trying to figure it out, say, okay, what did you mean by this? Wait a minute, hey, let's just give you permission to do anything and everything right this very instant. full permission and empower, all empowerment to you. And we'll, you know, we got enough faith and trust in you. We know you will... You'll do fabulous for us, fabulous. You will absolutely save us. You will absolutely protect us. So this lady in red may very well have been just a super ultimate protector, completely immersed in this mission of protection. These teachers are all about giving us spiritual momentum. Do you think for one instant they want to see us lose all that? Which is what is facing us, actually. And I always pray, I said, don't allow us to lose the momentum. Do not allow it to take place. I absolutely forbid it. You absolutely must act now and prevent us from losing our momentum. You absolutely must do this. I'm very adamant about it. Because I know how hard they've worked to build up the momentum. And so you cannot allow it to be lost. You absolutely cannot allow this. You must protect it. I insist upon it. I'm very fiery and adamant about that. I know how difficult it is to build up this momentum. And if you lose it, how difficult it is to get it back. It's just, you can't play around with this issue at all. You must take this with the utmost seriousness, what's taking place in this world now. Total seriousness, total seriousness. Well, this lady was totally red. Totally red. Totally ready, totally red, totally interested into protecting our spiritual momentum. So be really fiery and adamant to insist that these great Dharma protectors play their cards now and full on take all steps that they deem necessary and effective, all steps, right this moment. We're not going to wait another moment for you to take these steps. You must take them right now. And we're, what, 11 days away from May 17th? I'm sorry, from May 27th. Today is the 16th, actually. So we're 11 days away from May 27th. And this day could be the beginning of this flushing of the toilet, really. On just trying to flush everyone down the drain. It could really commence that day. Now, those who don't have any spiritual momentum to lose, what do they care? I mean, they're just shrugging. Well, I don't see anything wrong with the world. Yeah, I don't see any persecution. I'm not being persecuted. I'm not worried. It's kind of like if you're a minority and you're persecuted, severely persecuted. The majority says, what? I don't see any trouble. I'm not being persecuted. What are you talking about persecution? I'm not being persecuted. Well, the minorities, they certainly know that they are. So if you have spiritual momentum in this world, a lot of spiritual momentum, especially, you know very well that you're under the gun of severe persecution here. And the attempt is to eradicate your momentum. There's no question about it. Same way a minority knows that they're not welcome here. They're not welcome in this place. So there's all these people in the world say, what are you talking about? There's no big problem. Everything's fine. You know, we got our television and our, you know, food and, you know, what's the big deal? Football season's coming up this autumn. Everything's fine. This is a case, you know, just a ridiculous attitude. They're not the ones that are being persecuted. So what does that mean, that no persecution is taking place? It's nonsense. Of course it is. The intent is to eradicate all spiritual momentum on this planet, turn it into a secular materialist haven, or hell, really. So those who have spiritual momentum, they know very well the gun that they're under. And they are desperate for help. I'm desperate for help. Because I know that the way that pressure is going to be applied in this world, they could just crush you, actually. They could just crush you. They're just crushing. They can crush me. They can crush anybody here. Except they can't crush the Dharma Kings. They can't crush Vajra Yogini. No. They could try to take a bite out of her, they're going to break their teeth. So we rely on these beings, enlightened beings. We rely upon them for help under this crisis, emergency situation. That's what they're there for. For goodness sakes, you got a fire, what do? You try to put out the fire yourself, or do you call the fire department? I mean, this is what we're talking about here. Your house is on fire. Your spiritual momentum is being burnt to the ground. The house of spiritual aspiration momentum that you built, the arsonists are burning it to the ground. They're throwing Molotov cocktails in there. And what do? You grab your garden hose and say, hey, you know, stop doing that. You know, you're burning my house down, spray, you know, it's fine. No, you call 911, you get the fire department out there, and the whole fire department comes rushing. It's a 6-alarm fire. They're all there. And they got full-on fire hoses, just blasted the place, just putting the fire out like that. You call the experts, you call the professionals when your house is on fire. They know their business. They know how to put out a fire. We don't know how to put out a fire like that. We don't have got a garden hose, for goodness sakes. They got fire hydrants and engine and water tankers with high powered pumps coming in. And foam and everything that they and the firemen jump in, and you know, they know how to do it. Vajrayogini is like a fire lady. fireman, firewoman. She comes in there and says, I'm going to put out this fire. Fire can't touch me. Fire can't touch me. Fire touches me, it goes out. So call the professionals when your house is on fire like this. And it's like the Germans in World War II, prior to World War II. They say, well, we don't have any problems. Everything's great with us. And people say, what about the Jews? I mean, they seem to be getting persecuted. They say, we're not having any trouble. No one's persecuting me. Right? So sometimes persecution is going on right under your nose. Now, of course, again, we're all innocent. Nobody can do anything against our will. That is very true. However, we do have old ancient habits and a continuity fear, which can be exploited. Ultimately, we're agreeing to exploit it because we're afraid. So yeah, we do give permission, but we're giving permission because we're afraid of the alternative of not giving permission. So that's really not an ideal situation at all, is it? It's not a good situation. So we absolutely are right in saying that there is this purpose to eradicate our spiritual momentum, because many find that very threatening to them, and we may end up being so pressured that we'll end up agreeing with them and then deciding to collapse our momentum, and then it will be collapsed. This is the trouble. Nobody can force the collapse against our will, but they can influence us such that we decide to collapse it. That is true. And yet, because we've decided to play this game, they're still innocent and we're still innocent. Okay, there's no way to lose our innocence ultimately, but it can certainly seem that we can be under undue pressure. So it can certainly pragmatically seems that way. So we do want help. We do want all the help we can get. We want it right today. We want it today on Pentecost. We want it absolutely full blast. Firemen, full blast. Hoses, full blast today. Protect our houses from the arsonists. We know throughout history the persecutions that have taken place, and once that persecutional fever starts, it's difficult to stop, and it has taken place many, many, many times throughout history. This is the play of this world, and we're absolutely naive if we think this play cannot take place again. In fact, it's taking place a lot of places in the world already, isn't it? But there have been sophisticated cultures. Well, we thought this could never take place, and it absolutely took place. I mean, look at the French Revolution. What happened to the clergy and the religious people, et cetera, all those. I mean, it was just like, it was ghastly, right? And they were a very sophisticated culture. Look what happened in Germany, very sophisticated culture. Look at the situation with the Holocaust. You go on and on and on and on and on, actually. So sophisticated cultures do persecute. They do. They absolutely do. We think the United States isn't capable of persecuting its own citizens. So of course it is. Of course it is. The mindset is already there. It's incredible what the mindset is. I mean, you feel like we're on the verge of something like the French Revolution here. Let's persecute religious people. They're crazy. That's what they think. They're crazy. They're out to get us. They have this paranoia complex. It's amazing that somehow religious Christians are going to suddenly, persecute them or something. No, they just want to be allowed to. They just want the persecution to be lifted off their heads, and to believe what they want to believe. I mean, look how Christian Science has been, just absolutely outlawed, basically. I mean, they just want to feel free to follow their beliefs, which are higher beliefs actually than materialism. Christian Science is a wonderful teaching. No, you can't be sick. It's impossible for you to be sick. The belief that you're sick is just a mental error. It's really a pretense, is what it is. I mean, the language that Mary Baker had her use was, it was okay for the time. It can be it could be polished a little bit, you know, but the basic gist of it all was accurate, was true. And so all this stuff is just being absolutely eradicated and made illegal, and they'll be vaccinating everybody for everything coming up, right? And, you know, just basically tell you you're just a sick animal and nothing you can do about it except we got all these drugs we can give you. This is just, you know, abominable materialism. It is just disgraceful. So, we may have the top Dakini there is working for us now in this world. This may be the case. This is the good news. Vajrayogini. Basically the counterpart of Vajrasattva, and they say, you know, she is like, she's the like female activity of the Buddha. I don't know why they call it female activity, but that's just the way they symbolize it. I guess she's a protective deity, and that women are fiercely protective of their children. And since we're children of the Dharma, the fierce protectiveness of that would be symbolized as a female figure. So she's this tremendous, committed protector of all those on the spiritual path. Just like a mother would be tremendously protective of all her children. So that's why they use this, you know, female symbology, anthropomorphic symbology. So it's getting very interesting here in the world, right? So keep in mind, you're absolutely within your rights to call down any and all spiritual protection you want to call down. You're absolutely within your rights. That's what they want. That's what they're waiting for. So just do it. Don't wait. Do it. Give out the empowerments. Keep in mind that you're equal son of God to everyone else. So certainly you can give those empowerments. Protect the truth, because here we're so feeble, we're so prone to losing it. Materialism is like Godzilla, rampaging. Yeah, through the world. It's just breathing fire everywhere, setting everything, all our buildings on fire, all our spiritual momentum, just trying to incinerate it. That's not a good thing, is it? Better call upon the firemen to put out the fire. Yes, we better. And we can. We can do this. We can do this. Nothing is stopping us, actually, if we just understand. Give them the offer. I offered. I said, I'll take you down. I'll take you down the stairs. I'm willing to do that. I said, why not? Why not? It looks like you need some help. This will help you out. I'll do it. And I did it. So they're just waiting for your hand. Hold out your hand and say, I'm willing for you to help me. And then they'll help you. This is how it works. You hear all these songs about Jesus, take my hand, take my hand. Well, we got to hold out our hand and say, Jesus, I'll take your hand. Jesus can't say, hey, give me your hand, give me your hand. We reach up to Jesus, hey, Jesus, here's my hand, take my hand. I want you to help me, take my hand. And we have to offer our hand. You know, yeah, that's how it works, offer our hand. And so, of course, I'm very much into protecting spiritual momentum. This is my purpose. So you better believe I'm going to ask for help in the most, you know, intense manner possible. Having suffered the way I've suffered, I understand what's at stake. So, at all costs, our spiritual momentum must be protected. At all costs. Any and every step must be taken that is necessary, must be taken. And we'll leave it up to them to decide what needs to be done. They know how, their business, and we're willing to allow them to do their, you know, to conduct their business. We allow them to conduct their business here. We have to invite them, say, conduct your business here, absolutely. Okay, so there you have it. Very interesting. Ten to 12th century. Grace, the grace of God's amazing, isn't it? It never ceases to amaze me. It just orchestrates everything at some level and knows everything, orchestrates everything. Has our back and is bringing us back to awareness of what we really are. That's its job. So thank you, grace of God. May everyone experience the grace of God ceaselessly and be aware of it and call upon it and give all empowerments and permissions to the grace of God to do any and everything necessary to protect our momentum towards awakening to what we really are. Very simple. Very simple. Okay. Very great. That's it for this one.